History is a chain of events, one leading to another. Our decisions plan our future. Through the 20s, 30s, and 40s, Houston opened up the Museum of Fine Arts and started developing small groups of artists meeting in places like the basement of the Bakersfield apartment house. The first real alternative art spaces was the Contemporary Arts Association, which later turned into the Contemporary Arts Museum. This documentary is about the events taking place in alternative art spaces in Houston that lead to Project Row Houses.
Project Row Houses is a project that started out reclaiming 22 little shotgun houses in a neighborhood in Houston called the Third Ward. There were 22 houses. We started to develop that with the idea of infusing the arts in this process. And since that time, it's grown to include a CDC that has built about 30 units of new constructed housing. We've done a lot of land assembly and have kind of utilized, hundreds of artists in our process of growth and development.
How did Project Row Houses get started? Let's go back to the 1940s. After World War II, Houstonians that wanted to show contemporary art formed the Contemporary Arts Association in 1948.
I think there are many, many, many things that happened. Some of the things that happened early on, I think, probably were significant. That the University of Houston, then a private institution, decided to, after the Second World War, put together an art department. This is because of Alfred Newman, who was somewhat later appointed dean, but they hired Bernhard Limmel probably about 1948, about the same time as the founding of the Contemporary Arts Museum, that the University of Houston made the move, this move, right at the end of the war, 1948. I do recall the University of Houston was a sea of Quonset huts, because of all of the soldiers coming back to get their degrees.
In the early 1960s, the University of St. Thomas opened an art history department with the help of Mrs. Dominique Demenil.
For years, the little University of St. Thomas, unknown outside the city almost, with the exception of the art program, had the largest art history department in the state. The largest art history department in the state of Texas, bigger than Texas, A&M, SMU, you name it, okay? They were looking here to see what we were doing with a fabulous program of visiting scholars, visiting artists, bringing in René Magritte, Marcel Duchamp, Max Ernst, Claes Oldenburg, Andy Warhol, to name some of the more notable artists. They came to that little University of St. Thomas.
By the end of the 1960s, Houston had an art scene.
Well, by definition, what constitutes an art scene? What is an art scene? You say, oh, this is an art scene. Well, what the hell is that? You know, what an art scene means is that there are people feeding off of each other's energy. It means that you feed off mine, somebody else feeds off yours, somebody feeds off all three of us's. The first thing you know, there is a community of people who are willing to be used. There's not any of this old bullshit, you know, like, they're just using me. Oh, really? Of course they're using you. That's what it's all about. You know, if I'm not willing to be used, then I'm selfish, you know. Our artists by nature, they're pretty generous people.
What do you mean, art crawl? What do you mean? He goes, And this is the guy who was sort of like in charge at the time. He goes, oh, well, it's a sort of a thing where people go to different open studios and it's very good for the artists. I said, well, that sounds great. I'll do it.
The 1970s started with two major events, the Main Street Happening and the Contemporary Arts Museum hiring Jim Heritus.
Houston, that's before you could even get a drink in Houston. When I finally was offered the opportunity to come here, I jumped at it. And when I got here and looked around, I saw that I saw it was a totally different kind of city. And as a different kind of city, it was pretty obvious to me that it was going to produce some kind of art that was, I would say, out of the ordinary. In other words, people in Texas, and it occurred to me right after I came here, were not as tied to Europe or New York, or as tied to the West Coast, or they were somewhere else. They were probably more tied south. And so that was a big factor in my coming. And the other factor was I was always interested in Mexico and South America and the rest of it. I had.
Yeah. So. Jim Heritus always operated on the premise, you know, that that his experience, his intuitiveness, his history would give him a directive. That's what strong leaders are.
There was very little interest in modern art. As I told you, was broke. The institution was broke. I was happy to take the job. I'm not complaining, but I had to take a break in salary, etc. But the institution was broke, and that struck me as a challenge. And raising money, which I don't think I'm very good at, was very difficult in those days. I remember going to one of the captains of industry in Houston and giving him a pitch about how important contemporary modern art is going to be for the consciousness of the people and for people coming in the rest of it. And after I finished my speech, he put $100 on the table. I mean, give me a break. It was difficult. I remember going out to see John Biggers, and he took one look at me and he said, you look like a kind of guy who wants to come down here and change things. He said, you better move so slowly.
When he got here, he was followed by a student of his named Mark Lombardi, who had been in one of his museum management classes in Syracuse. And so Mark came down here and just showed up at the museum and began working. He and Jim got in Jim's truck and drove all over the state trying to catalog Texas's own artists, because this is something that Jim was really excited about. They went all over the state. They went to Dallas. They went to El Paso. They went into New Mexico, where a sculptor named Luis Jimenez was working. To meet with him. They went to Galveston to meet Michael Tracy. And of course, he made it a point to meet as many Houston artists as he could find.
One of the best things that I ever did in my life was to go up there and look at James Searles' work. And actually, it was John Alexander who encouraged me to go up there and see his work. So I went up to Dallas, found him working in Dallas, and saw what he was doing and realized almost immediately that this man was challenging New York. And that to me was big time, and it was really important to show his work.
Jim Heritus was, in essence, a mentor for me. I lived in Dallas, and I met him in 1974. He came to my studio. I'd never met him, I didn't know who he was. And he came to my studio on a quest. He traveled all over the state. He went to San Antonio, he went to Austin, he went to Dallas, Fort Worth, he went to El Paso, he went to Beaumont, he went all over. And he did something that no other museum type had done before. And that is, he came up and knocked on your door and said, hi. You know, I'm Jim Heritus. I'm the director of the Contemporary Art Museum in Houston. You know, I've heard about what you're doing. I'm here to look. Well, what could be more inviting to an artist? I mean, artists are not used to that. That's a
work. So I was able to get a show together of his work, which turned out to be a better. Oh, well, I put together a kind of museum show of 40, 50 pieces. Searles arrived with 125 pieces, so I mean, he wasn't going to leave anything out of the show. Had a big chance to show down in Houston. What do you mean? And subsequently, he moved down to Houston, and I think his work was really deeply, and his leadership among the artists was really tremendously important. So
he kind of nursed me, in a sense, through into a bigger picture. One was the fire show. The fire show opened the door for a lot of things to happen. It was exciting, you know. There was a 100 artists in the state of Texas all of a sudden got their foot in the door. That's huge. That was a big deal. Now, again, it's like Jim Harris. If you help 100, that means that there's probably 3,000 that he didn't help. So there's always a faction out there that says, well, they're not doing enough. They can't do it all.
I had met James Searles once through the show that he had at the Contemporary Arts Museum. But everybody was in it. He had curated it along with Jim Harrison. And so I went to James Searles and said, well, James, why am I not in the show? Well, of course, nobody even knew who the father was. Excuse the expression. Nobody knew who the heck I was at that time. And he said, I don't know you. Who are you? And so then I made a point to know who he was.
The Damon Hills decided to leave St. Thomas and take their department and move to Rice. So that's St. Thomas. St. Thomas was experienced like Lawndale when he was under the watchful eye of the Catholic Church. But we had our moments, but it wasn't anything like what was gone over at U of H, God.
And John Alexander and James Searles were at U of H, and they were going around the country doing talks and trying to attract people to Houston. And Michael was attracted by those guys and came to Houston in 1981, I believe.
And by coincidence, out of, you know, 4 million people in the city, I was there for less than 2 weeks, I ran into Wanda Alexander. And she invited me to come back and meet John, and I did. I met John. And I was telling him about problems at the University of Texas and, you know, the way they want to manipulate your art, tell you what to paint, how to paint. And he told me, the only thing that I grade on is if you work hard, you'll make a good grade in my class, and I don't care what you paint. Which was phenomenal, and was like, wow, I'm going home and packing my stuff. I'm going to the University of Houston.
We all had studios in the Art Barn. You know, the new art building, fine arts building, had been finished at that point, but it was also pristine and clean. Nobody wanted to work over there. We all had our studios in the barn.
The big problem was when Searles moved in and trying to have a room for his sculpture department, it just got too big too quick.
Searles had an enormous outdoor sculpture that intended to be outdoors, but he was working on it inside the barn.
We've already outgrown it. The architectural department side of it, which they were crammed in the same building, they had a fire, and then there was, what are they going to do with the art building?
It caught on fire, and that's what caused them to go looking for an alternative art studio space. And they found one that wasn't connected, you know, to the museum, which turned into Longo. The rest is history.
And it never would have happened had that art building not burned. The upper tiered level people there, the provost, the chancellor, the dean, they were all unbelievably apologetic about giving us that building to work in. Oh, we're so sorry you have to go over into that big warehouse off campus. We're doing the best we can. We'll get you a new building as soon as we can. Well, duh. They might as well have given us a Ferrari. They gave us a race car. They gave us all we needed was octane. They gave us the space.
And in front of me at Gourmet Burger were two gentlemen who were literally sparks flying from them. And it was John Alexander and James Searles. And they were speaking about this space. This is going to be this space. Something had burned down and something was going to be great. And, you know, I was just hearing bits and pieces of it, but I knew then I had to be a part of it, whatever it was. For about the first 5 weeks of class, we got notes on the door that said, it'll be here, we're coming. And finally one day, we met over at this building in the middle of the winter. They opened the door and suddenly there was just vast, as far as you could see, yellow walls everywhere. But it was just this enormous warehouse space, and we had just been told, this is yours. This is yours to do whatever you want to, think of the possibilities. And I think that's why it was so fantastic, is that the possibilities were endless.
After the fire of the art building at the University of Houston, there was a really wonderful free space devoted off campus. There was a kind of independence developing. I don't even think there were walls up.
What I call, and what was called in that day, an alternative. Well, hence Lawndale.
And Searles was the most amazing person to be there. He just would not say no to any idea. It didn't matter what it was. If you came up with an idea, he would say yes to it.
I remember going to a lot of shows right in the middle of the big gaping open warehouse and that Searles had organized, including Powwow, the first opening show with Burt Long's exhibition.
I went out to Lawndale and we were talking, and I went to him with an idea and a proposal. And I told him, I want to do Powwow. It wasn't named Powwow. I told him I want to do an Artist and Models Ball. I thought that Houston should do that. And James said, well, let's do it.
That was a strange connection. Artists, models, lawyers, and chefs.
I just simply said, oh man, yes, you can participate. You can have a slice of the pie, meaning you can have a show, you can be in a show, but for that, there was a price. And the price was the participation meant work. It equaled work. It's like sweat equity, you know, and the community was ready for sweat equity. There was a labor force in existence. There were two of them. One was the students, University of Houston students, who were also at that time, they were in full lather. They were worked up. They felt it. They knew what was going on. They could sense, you know, some real dynamic possibilities. And man, they would work like Trojans. I mean, at any given moment at Lawndale, I could go get 30 students to help me do anything on any day. That's huge. That is huge to be able to do that. Well, in the process of doing that, there was one other thing, and that was the community at large, the art community at large. Suddenly, they had a venue. They had a doorway that they could enter into that doorway, and things would happen. And they could participate. And they did. We had a lot of space. We did a lot of shows. We did a lot of things. And it was almost like all you had to do to get a slice of the pie was participate. If you were willing to participate, you got a slice of the pie.
So it
it just had a nature about being in the community more than being, you know, in an academic environment.
The people that came in and inspired us were unbelievable people. I mean, where else can you be 20 years old and have Phillips Glass and the Houston Grand Opera practicing Panther underneath you, and the steel drum band there practicing every other night, and see Allen Ginsberg and Laurie Anderson. And we were just walking amongst these people like we were equal to them. Hey, bud, what's going on? And we just, you know, it was just an experience that...
My role in it, ironically, was just simply to tell people that they could do it.
Me, James Searle's idea for Lawndale was to give these students a chance to have their first real studio experience where they could go in, they would be responsible for maintaining their own studios, for doing their work.
And how much the students themselves contributed to the craziness, the enthusiasm, the just no holds barred, let's have a good time, let's make art, let's make history, let's become something.
Essentially, the main body of the university didn't even really know we were out there. And no one cared if we went and blew things up in the parking lot or that people lived in the, you know, and took showers in the sinks and stuff like that, and or that I had a keg of beer in my shop.
Secondhand, but like my favorite story is that Robert Shuttlesworth supposedly lived in a broom closet there for 2 years. You weren't supposed to live at the building. They would be up all night long, you know, hanging out and just really living like artists.
And being around all those other guys, you know, Paul Kittleson and Jack and Michael Baldwin and Carter Ernst, and, you know, they just worked their butts off. All they wanted to do was make stuff. So, you know, and I just fell into it and I loved it. Bob Borden said, just make me out a little space over there and just keep working. That's the only instructions I ever got, keep working.
The group of people that I met at Lawndale, we just all got along so well. And sometimes, you know, for all of me talking about what a pain in the butt artists are, sometimes it actually worked. People would just go out, and not for money, not even to be well known, just because they'd think of something cool to do, and they'd go and do it. And then someone else would think of something else they could add to it, and they'd go get it and add to it. And we'd end up with an actual group production put together by a bunch of artists with, you know, only a minimum of, you know, name calling and so on. I mean, sometimes, certainly not all the time, but sometimes it really did work. To this day, to still be able to go and, you know, borrow a bunch of stainless steel washers from somebody or drill a hole in a hammer or whatever the case may be. And everyone still does that. I mean, I do it. I'll go, I can't find a place to buy this kind of rod. But then I know that Paul bought some, so I'll call him up. Maybe he'll have a name, you know, someone I can go for. So that sort of stuff still goes on all the time with the same group of people.
For me personally, there was a climactic moment, and that was Fresh Paint. When Fresh Paint happened, there was a huge review in Art in America about that. There were 7 people from the University of Houston in the museum, and there were pages devoted to those 7 people. Now, that had never happened before. Kind of the icing on the cake for Lawndale. It was a whole group of people that got to be in the Museum of Fine Arts, they got to be in Art in America, they got really recognized.
I showed up at Commerce Street and Lawndale, right at the cusp, right when it sort of was starting to be, you know, populated, and right when Lawndale was going out. Because I think the Minutemen had their infamous brouhaha with the University of Houston security or the police or whatever that was, and Moira Kelly was tired, and it was the UH didn't want Lawndale anymore, really.
And I was reading a bit in the early 80s about Houston, the arts community here. I mean, there was lots of buzz about Houston. So I decided with a friend, we drove over here one weekend, and I thought it was pretty cool, and came back, moved back several months later. But one of the first experiences I had here when I drove over to Houston just to visit was an old building that was abandoned where the Chelsea Market is now.
Yeah, that was the first place I saw when I came to Houston that gave me a clue that it was an interesting place. It looked like a hospital-like building or some kind of big building that was behind a whole bunch of weeds. All those weeds and stuff, it was a pathway you could go to. And there was art stuff happening there. I knew it was. Because when I showed up, the reason that it was like something out of a weird movie. But I walked through the pathway of these weeds and got to the building, and all I remember thinking was that there's something really weird going on in here, because there was lots of graffiti painted stuff, but there was also like a fire in the building, like not a fire, but where somebody had been cooking.
1983, George Arand and Lee Benner rented an abandoned building that was Consolidated Meats Warehouse, where they opened Consolidated Arts Warehouse to put on theme parties showing art and music. Before it closed, it was a venue for Houston's punk bands. The first show was Dance with Live Artists.
Well, Consolidated Arts Warehouse was on Montrose, right near 59, and it was made into a sort of an alternative art space by a group of artists. I think Lee Benner was involved with that, amongst other people. And just being in the art world in Houston, you sort of heard about different things, and I heard about it, and I came over and helped out. And you would go in there, and they had art shows and performances and all sorts of crazy things going on all the time. Parties, theme parties, sort of like raves, but not quite raves. The raves I don't think were really started yet. They're just warehouse parties. And I showed my work there and performed there. And
in 1982, developers bought land and buildings just north of Buffalo Bio off of San Jacinto, hoping to make good on their deals when it was developed. They rented out to artists in the meantime.
Actually started in Lee Benner's studio first time, and he let me take a little space because I said I had wanted to get a big rock, and I brought it in from like Vermont or something like that. It was a really tough piece. It turned out to be a big giant block of chert, which about killed me.
Artists like John Calloway moved into the neighborhood. Within a year, there were 50 artists there. They got together and formed Artist Warehouse Alliance.
You know, started getting a little bit better control, started working on nice marbles, doing sculpture over there outside, had a little outdoor area. And then there was a building next door that was like a bombed out kind of building. Moved into B&B building, you know, because I needed a little space. And that was kind of like my first personal studio, in the B&B upstairs. And it was a really rough building. I turned it into an art gallery called The Space. And The Space proved, I guess, 10 or so art shows. Something like that. And actually it was the first place that Frank Martin got shown declaring himself as an artist, you know. So I think just through all that, that's how I got connected up with, you know, all these groups. But you know, I never was that active in any like formal organization. I was, you know, to me, you know, this was like fabulous just to be able to come down and work and, you know, get my mind off of oil and gas business and stuff like that and focus on making art.
I had a studio over in what became known as NoHo when the rents got really high, and there was a sculptor in there renting from me named Tony Colasardo, who had a studio sort of at the Cox Blackburn building,
And we moved over there and lived on the second floor for a while. And then the building got sold. And I went next door and asked George Morgan if I could rent the place in the back. And he told me if I could and gave me a good deal. And I started moving back there.
On the Commerce Street, I just wondered who we could rent this place to, and this Billy Benner came up and said, I don't know whether you own the buildings or not, but I sure would like to rent that little space in the back there. And so we said, well, it's been vacant for 20 years, we'd be happy to rent it to you. It's in pretty bad shape, but if you want to clean it up, we'll give you 2 months free rent. You can clean it up, move in.
And the where Commerce Street is today had been vacant for 20 years, and he wanted to rent it out so that it wouldn't be carried on to insurance as an abandoned building. And I told him, well, I could rent it out. And it had been a big a real estate company that tried for a long time and couldn't rent it. And I told him I could have it rented out in 30 days, and he said, well, go for it.
Lee Benner told me, he said, well, if you let me rent the space, within 30 days, I'll have your other building full. And sure enough, within 30 days, all the people from Commerce Street Artists moved in. So that's how it all started.
The owners had no other clients than these artists. I mean, I think as far as the real estate owner, they would have preferred to rent this place to a business, but there was no business to take care of. I mean, that it would fit in those buildings.
First time that I came here, I believe it was a party at Lee's. Of course, the place had rained, as it always rains in Houston. There was no electricity in the building. All the electricity had been stripped out by the 10 years that all these homeless people had been living here.
You know, I remember, you know, I came down here for a Halloween party at Lee Benner, and there were a bunch of the people, you know, Wes Hicks, and that gang from Lawndale were here, and we all kind of like, there was, you know, we wanted to go over to the next building at night, you know, and there was, you know, no electricity in the building, rats running everywhere, and piles of debris all scattered through it, trash, and, you know, hobos all in the back. I mean, it was just, you know, really, really something else and scary, you know. And there were, they put lights through there, some candles and stuff through there, so it made it really, actually probably the most spooky, you know, Halloween place I've ever been in, no kidding.
And the roof was rotten and it had rained. And so I remember walking into the main front room, and people were riding around on roller skates. They had like flashlights or candles. And it was just this huge black, almost like, it seemed like a cathedral. It was just so big and empty and black with these black pools of rainwater standing everywhere. It was a strange and magical kind of place. It wasn't like any place I'd ever been in my life.
And then somehow that night, you know, I remember I said, I want to go over there and get me a space. And Wes, they're always, you know, already saying, well, we're gonna go take over it too, you know. And basically, it was just, you know, all just kind of happened. Crazy how it happened. You know, we just formed all of a sudden after that party. I mean, within weeks, people were roaming around there trying to figure out who was going to take what space, because it was a giant warehouse at that time. And, you know, it was 50,000 square feet or more of just open, no walls, no electricity, no toilets. Well, there was a toilet, one in front. That's it, one in front. And back then, they used to bring, you know, poor Hispanics back down the alleyway here and beat them up, the cops, and, you know. Pretty scary place down here. It's that big old building. There's a huge train station across the street that was abandoned with all these windows broken out of it and birds flying around. And the building was so big it made all of Commerce Street like dark. Like the place, it was scary. I mean, at that time, Commerce Street really was an abandoned, you know, bygone bunch of buildings. They were all, you know, going to hell.
Wes and Kevin, and also Jack Masson, were very keen to try and find a place where they could continue the experience they'd had at Lawndale. Made contact with the landlords through Lee, and started hauling all the trash out of the building. And I think the most amazing visual experience I ever had here was when we hydroblasted.
Steve Wellman and Wes Hicks were power washing the whole of just a big empty space. And you know, of course, it dried by the time they were done, it was dry. They just sat and put down masking tape, and there's your studio.
Rick Lowe, stopping for a beer on his way out of town to go home, had profound effects on the history of Houston.
I moved to Houston in 1985, and I was looking for studio space, and I met Lee Benner at, I think it was a River Cafe, and I was telling him that I was interested in a studio space, and he told me about a place that he had downtown, just east of town. I went down to visit. He said that, he would allow me to use part of his space in a large warehouse in response to me doing a little work for him, helping him out. And I was very excited, so I was set to do that until he informed me that the building next door was going to be rented by a group of artists and that I should join them, which would create a studio opportunity for me. The founding of Commerce Street, while I was one of the four artists in the early founding of it, although I wasn't really technically, because as Lee Benner can attest, that when he first told me to go over and talk to this group of artists about being involved with them in the claiming of that space as a studio space, they immediately told me no, that they didn't want me, they didn't need me, because I wasn't a part of the Lawndale group, and this was a Lawndale group of artists that were actually doing this. And I remember Lee telling me, he said, well, and he was just saying this from experience, he said, you know, well, don't worry about it, just give them a few weeks, you know, they'll be screaming for you to come back and help, because everybody's going to, you know, they're at that particular time when they were first looking at it, it must have been somewhere around 15 or so artists that were all gung-ho about doing this new thing. But as they began to realize that it was going to take resources, a lot of time, money, and, you know, stuff that just, that they were going to have to come up with, people dropped out. And so, true enough, they called me up and they said, you know, oh, are you still interested in being involved in this warehouse thing we do? And I said, yeah. And I went down, and that's when I, you know, became a part of it. But it was about a couple of weeks before they realized that they needed more support. And Lee Benner, who was the person that was there early on and kind of opened that door for all of that to happen.
And then next time we'd come in there, people would make walls of junk, you know, and that would be the borders. And then usually it was old crates and stuff and exhibitions. So the next thing you know, there'd be a wall built. So it was kind of funny to watch how it, you know, there's no plans, it's just basically tape on the floor, and this is your spot.
Commerce Street is a venue where various artists of different age groups and different political persuasions could come together and express themselves as a collaborative whole. And we were able, as such a unit, to touch the world. We had pierced punks. We had multi-millionaire oilmen. We had starving teachers. We had flower girls. We had performance artists, musicians, painters, sculptors, metal workers, playwrights.
Downtown was empty. I wondered where all the people were, you know, it was like a backdrop or something. There was nobody there. And so I went over to Commerce Street, and they had just started painting the building, and I said, hey, great. And they welcomed me, and, you know, I started living there. Actually, Rick Lowe and I were the guys there, living there, together. There was nobody else there. They would all go home. And at the time, there was no electricity. I managed to get a tiny air conditioner stuck in there, so I had a little hibernation place. Later, I built a plastic yurt and lived in the yurt, tore down all the walls inside my space. And then, you know, the hallway walls, I think, were the first things to go up.
Is Nestor in?
Yeah, Nestor's in here. All right. Super fast.
Hey. Hi, Nestor. I wanted to visit you.
Fine, honey. Basically, the art car stuff started then too. Jackie Harris with her automobile, and people just, you know, it was very, very impromptu and sort of just arose that way. Gradually, the stuff started evolving. As more people came in, more walls would get built, and more things would happen.
That kind of was just, it was purely just, okay, who could build walls fast enough and then divide up how much it cost, and everybody would chip in a little bit. And somehow, you know, it just formed organically, yes.
An open space that we need to figure out how much real estate I could take over, and went with my guys and build the walls and had a bunch of sailcloth from all sales that we subdivided the shops with sailcloth, so it was very maneuverable to have different areas for painting or carpentry and, you know, building a prototype, kind of a semi-clean environment here and there. And started building pieces of the space station and models and for NASA, you know. And so I felt a little out of place, you know, in this community, you know, of sculptors, painters, you know, jewelry makers, all kinds of different artists. And I'm there looking at space station stuff. And so, but I think, and I like to think that it was inspiring for the people that were there, that I was there. You know, so this interaction of different worlds, different ideas, and different ways to approach form, really, because I was solving problems with the design. I think some, in terms of art, people are just way freer. So I felt, you know, surrounded by a lot of more free spirits than I was. So it really helped a lot, you know, to be in that mix.
Guillermo Trotti was terrific. He was teaching the experimental architecture program at the University of Houston. And Craig O'Connell was there with him.
And in my world of architecture, it inspired me to, you know, when I was thinking about something, I would just walk to John Calaway's studio and, you know, he was, you know, chipping away at marble and, you know, we had maybe a 30-minute conversation, 20-minute set of ideas, and I would go back and work, and or they would come to my studio and have this kind of open studio feel that everybody was walking in and out of everybody's work and having comment and support. I think I thought that was really one of the most creative and fun times of my life. I mean, it was very rewarding to be surrounded by artists.
To me, Commerce Street epitomized what Houston is all about. It's a place that's about having the individual will or the will of a group of people to just, you know, press forward and make something happen. You know, this was a group of artists with no money.
John Calaway, everybody ridiculed him though, because he was like the rich guy that came in and, you know, dabbled and wanted to be an artist.
It was the first time for me where I was around very, you know, strong, opinionated individuals who had a lot to say, you know, both artistically and intellectually, that didn't have anything to do with business. That's the great thing about the big warehouse thing. You know, there's this real space for people to spread out and make paintings. They got a sculpture area, painting area, you know, And that's what Commerce gave everybody.
And I can't remember the first time I came to a party at Commerce Street, but there were parties that I first started coming to that were always just happening parties. And they were always very intriguing and cutting edge.
Top secret party here.
Oh yeah? Fingers in your back, thank you.
Yeah, the really good parts in here.
Production was through James Gale. And James Gale is an incredible actor and a really great director too. And he was the actor and director behind the King Lear production. He met Wes at a bar somewhere and they hit it off.
We did that King Lear and they showed up and they said, hey, you guys drinking beer over there by the welders, do you want to build a set for us? And we said, sure. It was
all of a sudden I show up with a truck and say, you know, is it okay if I come in and maybe light your show? And like, oh yeah, you can do whatever you want. And then I realized that Commerce Street had no lighting, but they had this huge performance space. And they're always doing stuff, regardless. I mean, they're undaunted.
Unlike a regular theater set where they take styrofoam and they paint it to look like steel, Scranton welded an estimated 2 tons worth of steel, scrap steel, into this huge multi-dimensional set that was actually really dangerous.
There were plenty of dogs living in Commerce Street. They were always howling. There were bats that live in Commerce Street that would fly around and buzz the audience during the show. When Lear goes mad, he's walking around on stage with a lantern with his cronies, and it starts raining because there's a 55-gallon drum that's filled with water with a submersible pump in it. And it got bitterly cold. There was one guy that played the bastard son, and he was wearing a loincloth, just shivering, delivering his lines, absolutely amazing. It was the most real production that I had ever seen. And we watched.
The most amazing experiences I had was getting to see James Gale productions, Shakespeare plays, and other kinds of classic theater that were just raw energy. It's the best theater I have ever seen, I think. King Lear was one that was fantastic. I mean, I still get a thrill when I think of that production. And the night we saw it, at the beginning, a pack of dogs ran through and out through the audience and the bleachers, and then the language began, and it was so powerful. I thought it was brilliant. And I don't know, I think I learned later that the dogs might have had that on their own agenda.
It's probably the only King Lear production that had real fire and had real rain, because at the end of this production, the audience members, they just sat there, they were just stunned. And then after about 15 minutes, you know, they'd like finish mopping their tears away and they'd start the long walk down the hallway to the parking lot, you know, they parked out front.
Nestor and Rick decide to move out of Commerce Street.
I considered my time at Commerce Street to be extremely important to me, and it played an important part of my life and my career, because it was the very first time and exposure that I had had to being in a situation where you could take something from nothing and just build it without a lot of resources, but just applying yourself and willing something into being. And so that same understanding of possibilities and knowledge of that went into the efforts that Nestor and I put forth on the West End where he started Zocalo.
And because we had been disgruntled, right? And I, you know, wanted to leave Commerce Street.
But Nestor really was tired of his fights with Wes and all, and decided he wanted to move. And I was, you know, that was my running partner, so I was ready. So we moved.
So Rick and I had seen the space in Rice Military, which is an area up off Fagan Memorial, Washington, Westcott. Then we had Dean Ruck. We thought, when Rick and I got there, it was just a vast industrial, you know, light industrial complex. And there's a field, and there's, you know, there are buildings through the field. And I mean, how are we going to manage this place? It was just too much for us. I remember that one night we were all there. We just started sitting around a barrel, burning wood and scraps and stuff to stay warm because we didn't have any power.
Zocalo became Houston's rendition of a scrapyard circus olé with performance art and high wire acts.
So when I moved over to Fagan Street, I started trying to figure out how to connect with the community around, you know, political issues. And I knew Bernard Sampson, you know, and so Bernard had his progressive thing going on, and so I was just kind of hanging out with him and started going over the Shape Center a little bit. And doing all that stuff around the issues of police brutality and all that stuff, I was working doing stuff over at Shape. Art Shaw, convinced me that the organizing that we were doing around police brutality, you know, the attack on people there, was similar to the kind of stuff that was happening from an art standpoint, right? You know, there was all this stuff on freedom of expression, that kind of stuff. And so he encouraged me to try to utilize the organizing skills that I was kind of beginning to pick up a little bit through the community work over at Shape Center to do it in the art community. And so that's when I started kind of trying to plant the idea among the, you know, the little circle of people I was in. You know, we should start protesting some of this stuff, you know, whatever. You know, and then it just kind of caught on, and everybody, you know, I don't know how it caught on, I don't know who was responsible for it, you know, becoming an issue, but somehow it did become an issue that there was an opportunity to politically organize artists. And that's when the Union of Independent Artists then came up.
It was the front page of the business section news. Maxam Corporation is moving to Houston, Texas. And they asked him, so do you expect any harassment from environmentalists here? And Maxam said, no, we've had no problems with environmentalists in Texas or in Houston. And then the writer wrote, except for local artist Richard Roederer, who is currently curating a show to protest Maxam's corporation and their move into Houston, Texas. Oh my God, now I have to do this. And I said, how am I going to talk other artists into doing this? And on the very same day, I got an email or a phone call asking if I wanted to join the Union of Independent Artists. And it was like from Rick Lowe, where, you know, we were both at Commerce Street at one particular time. And they wanted to be this group to do social whatever, but they actually didn't have any idea of what they wanted to do. Meaning that the Union of Independent Artists, it was at Diverse Works, just so I wanted to find out more. And I really liked the idea that artists wanted to become organized where we could do a more social impact instead of, you know, artists working just on their little lives.
We are in the very, very beginning. It really, this is our first meeting. And if any of you have a great idea or have a dream or a vision of what you think this could be or what you think this organization could do, it's up to you to make it happen and to step forward with your own action and to help guide this.
I had no idea that this would happen, that this many people would turn out. But it came about basically because it wasn't just formed. I mean, this thing kind of sprung up out of need. There's a lot of artists in town that suffer a restraint. And those were the artists that I contacted in the beginning to see if we could deal with some of the restraints that we have. A lot of artists that deal with alternative types of art. And but when we came together, we realized that it would be a good opportunity to pull together all the artists in town to work toward the restraints that's put on, you know, whatever artists that are in town. And as we pull together and we start to deal with the problems that we saw in our immediate concern, we began to see other problems that were related to every artist in town, such as censorship issue. And to sum up, I know that if we come together as an organized community, I mean, it's communities that get things from the city. The city is not going to look around and see that this group needs this, or this group needs this, or this group needs that. I mean, they don't care about it. But if you bring the question up, if you bring something to them, then they're forced to listen. And I'm sure among this group, there's enough people here that we could actually state a real strong case through going to city council and just banging the way, letting them know that we exist and we're in need. And hopefully the organizations that are our liaisons can actually step forward and ask for the things that we're actually pressuring. Yeah.
But as long as there's something taking place in town that or internationally that we feel like we could have an impact on, then that's when we form a committee, an action committee, to work toward that.
That for everything we'll do, we'll form a committee. So we'll form a treasury committee, we'll form a newsletter committee. If things today come up that everyone here can reach a consensus on, it seems very important, we'll form a committee to look into that.
The Union of Independent Artists.
It's an oxymoron.
The Union of Independent Artists. Now there's one of those bizarre, this sounds like a country song. You know, how the hell are you going to get a Union of Independent anything? You know? It's very interesting. Though, you know, and the fact that they were willing to get together and just shoot the breeze. You know, they were willing to get together and kind of lay cards on the table face up. I think out of that, really great stuff happens.
Rick had just finished a one-man show protest about the Exxon Valdez.
Meet artist Richard Roederer and take a look at one of his latest paintings, an animal skeleton swimming in oily muck, along with an Exxon credit card, with Exxon misspelled.
I thought it was more appropriate with the P as far as XU, and which is kind of a small generalization of their attitudes, just oops, you know, sorry about that.
The painting and other works of art were on display at a Montrose area restaurant. Wouldn't you know it, Thursday night, more than 25 people from Exxon came here for dinner. And no, they didn't like the painting.
So I explained to him, I'm going to curate this show, and I would like to use Commerce Street, and I don't want to go it alone then. And they all loved it, so it just bloomed, and it was a great show. I actually got a parade permit, and all the Union of Independent Artists, we made costumes, we made floats.
Connected with these guys was that the Union of Independent Artists opportunity to politically organized artists. And that's when the Union of Independent Artists then came up. That's, and I've known Burke before then. I didn't really know Jesse. I mean, I knew who Jesse was, and we had been in shows and stuff.
Right.
Like the Midtown show we were in, and like that was early. That was when I first got to town, in that Midtown show. What was that show called? I can't remember the name of it.
At Midtown?
Yeah, at Midtown.
Oh, with all of us in there?
Yeah.
Yeah. That's what, and it was you, me,
Floyd,
Fletcher.
Fletcher, Bert,
Jesse.
James Battison.
James Battison.
Oh, we're trying to do a fundraiser for Kumbaha.
But I didn't consider these guys like my family of friends. You know, I mean, Nestor and Jim Pearl, that was my family of friends and stuff. That's what I was hanging with. And when we were doing the Union of Independent Artists stuff, it was all going fine, right? But then at a certain point, we were doing all these freedom of expression things. Then we started doing these environmental things, you know. So, because from my background, and I wasn't trying to put too much of that out there, but I was trying to do political organizing. I mean, artists was just a particular group, but I was interested in the whole thing of, you know, what happened to low-income people, right? And so I remember naively thinking, well, we've got all these, this artist union group organized, and we go and we get 300 people to, you know, protest medical waste incinerators and this kind of stuff, you know, whatever, happening over here in the Third Ward. And I had been trying to get people from, you know, that I knew from the Third Ward to come and support us for our freedom of expression stuff and for the environmental stuff.
Right.
And then I thought, well, maybe I could, you know, I should get them to come over and support us with the police brutality stuff. And I kind of threw that out of the meeting, and people kind of like looked at me like, well, we got some other things we have to do. And I was like, wait a minute. You know, I mean, we're trying to make the world a better place, you know? And I just got a feeling, and maybe this is just the way I internalized it, but I internalized it that there was just a wall that came up there.
That's right.
And it was like, you know, it's like, oh, we're not dealing with their issues that they want to deal with, so they don't want to play.
Yeah.
And that's when that was the first time I felt like I had been kind of burned, you know, by my family, right? My family of the art world.
Yeah.
And then I was like, you know, I was lost. I was like, shoot, I got, you know, this is not where I need to be. It must have been around 92 that somehow I connected with Bert and Floyd and Jesse, and somehow that happened, and that, I don't know what it was.
I don't know what it is. What I think, the way you put it in that context, I remember, you know, the UIA was all behind, you know, protesting the Gulf War, and we did a major organizing of that, a two-day symposium, an exhibition at Jack Pierce, so that's a national issue.
There's a part of it become clear to me that somehow after we connected, and it might have been because of like the thing I did at the Shape Community Center, the installation I built there, or maybe the thing at the George R. Brown, something like
that. That was
somehow we connected there when we decided we were going to meet.
Yeah,
and that's when I first got to really engage with Jesse as, you know, somebody that we weren't just passing, you know, the night. We were like spending time together, whatever. And I was like, oh Lord. And Jesse was just, in his very skillful way of putting me in my place. I would constantly get put in my place over and over and over. And I was like, I thought out of the whole group, I said, okay, now Bert and I are good. Bert samples, you know, we've been good buddies or whatever. Floyd liked me, you know, whatever. You know, it's like, okay. And I was like, James Bettison, I was good because we were the same. I was like, good, you know. Then I was like, okay, Bert Long, I don't really know him that much, but he seemed to be all right. He seemed okay. And then George was quiet, and I didn't really say that much. But I was like, but that Jesse Young guy, he didn't like me. I was convinced of all of them. I was like, that Jesse Light guy, he didn't like me, man, but that's okay, because, you know, I was beginning to really, you know, appreciate that group and was really trying to find approval, you know. So that was kind of, I think I was probably overly asserting myself trying to get to.
What was that? That was in the
90s? That was like when we first went up to Burt Rosen's place.
The meeting that started Rojas's was held at my place up in Shepherd, Texas. We were all sitting around drinking wine and shooting the breeze and talking about stuff. And we said, we need to do something. And we want to do something. And I said, why don't we do something with the Rojas's?
But I know Burt wasn't, because Burt, by the time we had finished doing the talking and stuff, he was heading out. To Rome.
And in that period, Rick Lowe went and found the houses and did that. And basically, you know, it was his baby at that point. He went and did it. Rick Lowe went and did it.
At some point, I went to the group and said that, you know, I found a bunch of houses. After we came and we looked at the site, a good group of us at least looked at the site, and enough of us said, yeah, let's do it, that we decided, well, we should get some kind of official framework around what we're doing that could frame this in an art context. As Jesse was saying, make it known, not as just something we're just doing, but something that we're doing to push us onto the art world. And so we thought about, you know, how to do it. And somehow, maybe it was Jesse, probably, who suggested, let's have a meeting with Jim Harris. So we went over to Jim's place on North Boulevard and told him about this great idea that we're cooking up. So once we made contact with the owner, and he agreed to that we could lease the property from him, then we started the official nonprofit.
While we were sitting around trying to figure out what we're going to do to make a spectacular presentation at this site.
Right. Miss Ernestine Courtney was the sole resident of this whole, like, four-block area.
She didn't take no stuff.
And she was holding it down.
Because if it wasn't for her saying, look, y'all ain't doing nothing.
Yeah.
Some of these problems.
Yeah, that was it.
Some of these problems.
This woman was the moment that she kind of taught us or let us know what Project Rojas's really was about.
Was supposed to be about.
Yeah. Because see, we came here for the most part with the Burt Long idea.
Idealism.
Yeah, we need to be artists, and we need to make an impression of artists, you know.
Yeah,
so the idea
was
an art thing. But this woman who had lived here, she said, if y'all are going to do something for real, move the needle, or refocus Project Rojas.
That's the word, right? But what she said was, move the needle. If you make an effort to solve some of the problems that exist, then you will be doing something.
Yeah.
If you don't do that, you ain't doing nothing.
And just bringing over a bunch of artists to say, well, we got some artists over here.
You can make the prettiest picture in the world.
It wouldn't
make no difference, because you ain't solved one problem.
So once we got the corporation set up, then the guy actually came and we signed an agreement. I made a hand-drawn flyer asking for volunteers to come and help.
Rick tapped his friends to help him out at the very beginning, and before it had a name. You know, Dean rebuilt a porch, I cut down a tree.
More and more artists want to be a part of that. They want to be a part of the vibrancy of services that are needed in the city. And so, myself being one of those founding artists, I mean, that's kind of how I came to where I am now with Project Roadmap. That was always part of who I was as an artist and what I wanted to do. And, and also I always saw that it was the same thing that Lee was doing. So he was there as an individual with a studio there creating opportunities for others and supporting them.
To me, it's a classic Houston story. If you have an idea and you have the energy and you want to pursue it,
pretty much at a time, you're going to be able to get it accomplished. Somebody's going to get behind you and help you out.
Just the way you are, I said, just the way you are.